What is super hot? Needs a specialist for optimal function and has 18 fingers? This guy. Actually, it's a top fuel dragster clutch, and today we're getting deep into its many layers and what can cause it to get so hot that it welds itself together. Yeah. Freaking laying down dimes on the old clutch. Let's go. Top fuel dragsters produce an absolutely insane 11,000 horsepower, enough to trash their entire engine in just under 4 seconds. Pistons, rings, connecting rods, and spark plugs all have to be tossed after a single run. But we're not talking about all those components. Oh no, we're talking about their clutches. Those clutches can reach 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit, twice as hot as lava, and just a little bit hotter than your boy. Because of all that horsepower, these clutches get so hot that they can weld themselves together. So to figure it out, we first gotta see how a top fuel clutch works. Not to oversimplify things, but you probably know what a clutch does. It regulates power from the engine to the drive shaft and ultimately to the wheels. Now, the purpose of a top fuel clutch is the same as in any other car. You can think of a dragster clutch setup like a sandwich. Within the bell housing, you'll find the highly tuned top fuel centrifugal clutch. I call it centrifugal sometimes. Sometimes people say words differently. I'm gonna call it centrifugal because some kid yelled at me on Instagram about it. At the engine end is the flywheel, which forms that all-important connection to the dragster's 11,000 plus horsepower. And in this case, the flywheel would be a lot like the bottom bread of our sandwich. Then we have the filling, the nice meat that's inside, and that is the 5 or 6 disc clutch pack. The clutch pack is an alternating stack of 6 clutch discs and 5 steel floater plates. It really is the meat of the centrifugal clutch system and the source of a lot of the friction and heat that can cause the plates to weld themselves together. The base metal melting in a top fuel clutch is iron, and iron is super dense, melts around 2800 degrees. Now, typically more mass, especially dense mass like iron, means more heat energy dissipation, otherwise known as cooling. So heat energy dissipation across a dense surface means the heat energy is diminished as it spreads across that surface. And this is why the clutch doesn't weld itself together on every single run. But it does happen, and when it does, it's because of friction. That friction causes the clutch temperature to rise above the melting point of the clutch pack materials. The manufacturer and material type are tippy-top top fuel secrets when it comes to the plates and the disc. Steel floater plates are actually a blended steel unique to each team's tuning and performance calculation. And steel is just an alloy of iron and carbon, and the choice of ratios of metals in that steel will obviously have an effect on the clutch performance based on the friction or slippage that they provide. That blend can also be more or less prone to heat damage or welding. So that's the steel plates, right? But you also have clutch discs, and those are made of iron, specifically made of sintered iron. Well, what is sintered iron? Well, so freaking glad you asked. Here's some hot footage. Oops, sorry about that. That was just me with my shirt off. Here's some sintering footage. Sorry, I don't know why, just keep hitting the wrong button. For real, here's some sintered footage. Sintering is a process of putting parts made of compressed iron powder through a very toasty furnace and adding high pressure. The goal is to control the temperature so it reaches just below the melting point of iron without actually liquefying. The heat and pressure works at a molecular level, causing the metal particles to bond together so you get a stronger disc with enhanced properties from the original metal. It diffuses other elements, like carbon, that may be in the mix and reduces pore size, increasing the strength of the bonds between the particles. And because the discs are so dense from being heated and compacted during the sintering process, they can absorb and dissipate a lot of heat energy before their temperature goes up. Not only that, but sintered iron discs also have a super strong grip. It has a high coefficient of friction compared to a standard iron disc. They grip even better when they get hot. That's why you'll see a really quick burnout before a run. That not only gets the tires ready for the run, but it also warms up the clutch disc enough to start engaging better. That gives the disc the heat that they need to withstand slippage without sacrificing the all-important coefficient of friction that makes the clutch work. There are many different types of friction that we could get into here. There's static friction, sliding friction, rolling friction, the obvious friction between me and James on the subject of wheels.
You're making me regret having you on the show!
The obvious friction between me and my girlfriend when deciding where we're gonna go eat on Tuesday nights. It's B2B day. baby, okay? I get to pick. Tuesday's my day. You get all the other days. You get Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. I get Tuesday, B2B day, my day. But let's talk about the coefficient of friction, or how well or how poorly friction exhibits itself between two objects. In even simpler terms, just remember it like this. A higher coefficient of friction means the better a disc will be able to do its job. It also means a super harsh engagement, so more parts are sacrificed, but it's worth it so you can go faster down the track. That being said, the same sintering process that strengthens the material for more grip makes it ideal for welding. The lower the carbon content present, the easier it is to weld. And generally, low carbon metals have good weldability and do not require special process measures in order to weld with another metal. So when you combine the low carbon sintered iron with the steel blend plates, you're only a few factors away from a welded panini press of a clutch sandwich. Yum. On the other end of the clutch sandwich is a pressure plate, hat or cap. And it has many names and roles, including providing the pressure onto the clutch pack and the flywheel. There's a titanium donut, yes, a donut, underneath the clutch hat as well. Speaking of donut, if you want some cool, I'm not wearing a donut shirt. Speaking of donut, why don't you go to donutmedia.com and get some cool merch, like this donut pin. I don't have a donut shirt because I'm going to ninja practice today. So I had to wear my ninja shirt. No big deal. The two parts of the cap are held together with six stall springs. The springs can be adjusted to be free or loose so that the crew can push the vehicle to the burnout. Then, because the clutch has heated, the springs expand enough to make the clutch stickier. Now, mounted on the top of the hat are up to 18 clutch fingers, which sound creepy, little friggin' salad fingers, but they are essential to the operation. A traditional clutch uses spring steel arms to create the plate load needed to hold the clutch disc. A top fuel clutch uses centrifugal force and pistons to compress the clutch pack using a set of weighted levers on the pressure plate. Sound confusing? Well, it sort of is, and it's also why the clutch is really where tuning makes such a difference between wins and losses. Yeah, that's right. This clutch needs to be tuned. And the art of clutch tuning lies in the hands of a clutch specialist and crew chief, or more accurately, their fingers. They calculate the weights needed on the fingers as well as the timing map that will release the throwout bearing. The clutch fingers act as levers being forced out against the pressure plate, compressing the clutch and locking the friction disc and floaters together. So you have one whole assembly from the engine to the flywheel to the clutch to the wheels. Now that allows more power to be transmitted gradually to the wheels as opposed to all at once. You don't want that. You want a smooth operation so you can get that power to the wheels and not break traction so you can get a nice run down the drag strip. Later, sucker. Oh, you burned out? Get a new clutch man, dude. You need to tune your fingers more. Each of the clutch fingers can be adjusted individually to control locking of the plates. The six primary fingers, they'll all be the same length, all made of tool steel, but the secondary fingers, they can vary in length. That varying length will mean different timing for reaching engagement with the clutch. The addition of weights, usually in the form of nuts, can fine-tune the rate of clutch engagement too. So adding weights means the clutch will engage at a lower RPM on the initial hit of the throttle, whereas taking weight off will allow the motor to reach higher RPMs before fully engaging. Thinking about this in terms of centrifugal force present in the clutch, the more weight, the faster a lever will swing out. You can try it at home. Hold your arms in front of you and bend your elbows so that your hands are now in front of your face, okay? Now spin around as fast as you can. Okay, do you feel force trying to pull your arms out away from your body like this? If you do the same thing while you're holding, say, 5 or 10 pound weights, it'll be even tougher to keep your hands up and your arms in. That's centrifugal force at play. It's the apparent force felt by an object moving in a curved path that acts outwardly away from the center of rotation. It's that pull out when you're rotating, and it's what forces the levers out to engage the clutch. Now, if a track has plenty of grip, the crew chief will add weight to the clutch, meaning the power will be deployed quicker, resulting in a faster run. But if a track is slippery or it's wet, they will remove weight to provide a softer hit from the clutch. There truly is a fine line between pulling a fast run and just smoking the tires. And the interesting thing is the driver has no control over the clutch's engagement. I guess it doesn't matter if you're a good or bad driver. It's all up to the old engineers who are working on the car. The level of locking is really controlled by a pneumatic release bearing. As the driver hits the throttle, a micro switch initiates a pneumatic timer that controls the release bearing, sometimes called the cannon. This bearing limits the movement of the clutch fingers and locks in the clutch. As the clutch timer counts down, pressure is released from the system, moving the release bearing and allowing the fingers to lock the clutch up. Since only a very basic mechanical system is allowed, the timer sequence cannot be adjusted once the dragster is set to the starting line. So all these elements are set ahead of time. No adjustments can be made once the timing is punched in and everything has to go right, unless it doesn't. And then that can lead to, you got it, welding. Technology has changed over the years though, and most teams have upped the number of plates they use and improved the materials as well. But a clutch failure is still catastrophic. It means no power goes to the wheels and the run is over. You're also looking at costs, which add about $10,000 per run to replace all those parts. It's not a cheap fix. There's so many things that can go wrong in a dragster run that it's sort of amazing when things don't go wrong. And out of all the components involved in a successful run, ask any team's crew and the clutch will be at the top of their list for prioritized parts. The secrecy around materials used in the clutch and the calculations for each team is well-founded. A factor of mere grams on the clutch levers can make or break a run. So when you do see a win, know that there wasn't just nitro fuel and turbocharged engine power behind it. There's a little revenge there for us nerds. Determining all the weather and track conditions, inputting data into complex equations to determine weight ratios on levers, etc., etc. All that science and math that might not seem super cool actually wins or loses a run for the turbocharged dragster. Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of B2B. If you could, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, that really helps us out. If you guys wanna see more dragster content, leave a comment down below, let us know. Follow us here on Donut at Donut Media, follow me at Jeremiah Burton, and until next week, bye for now.